Well, welcome again, officially. Thank you for being here with us for our big show.
Thanks for having us.
2018.
Just a few of your friends?
Yeah, yes. 35,000 or six, or maybe it'll be 40 by the end of the week. But we're really pleased to have you. You're such great partners and collaborators with the NRF at every level, and such wonderful leaders in the retail industry. So
thanks.
We're delighted. And there's a lot we could talk about. And I was rereading the press release announcing your appointment as CEO that came out in late 2013. I was rereading that and some of the things Rob Walton said about why you were so uniquely qualified for this position. And it had to do with your lifelong commitment to Walmart, your belief in people, your ability to think about the global landscape and imagine the customer of tomorrow, and your agility on technological issues. And I just wonder if you could take a minute. You know, Bloomberg said that Walmart was making a bet on you, and some even were a little bit surprised, and you've certainly proved anyone that had a question about this.
Well, it's not over yet.
Ability.
We'll see.
It's too early in this story. We could talk about your personal journey a little bit and
your
time in the company.
My family moved to Bentonville, Arkansas when I was a teenager. My dad was a dentist and he opened a practice there, and I needed a job to help him pay my way through school. So I started unloading trucks at a warehouse, and I was shocked by how happy the people in the Walmart warehouse were, and ended up working for Walmart a few different times to help pay my way through school and graduate school, worked in a store, and then went into the home office. And along the way, being in the small town of Bentonville, you can't help but be around Sam Walton a little bit. There were different venues where I got to watch him lead, and then I was lucky enough to move from the store into the home office before Sam passed away and watch him lead Saturday mornings and get to have a few conversations with him. My first Saturday morning meeting, I got to present an item as a buyer, and Sam Walton was holding the microphone and having a bit of back and forth over that piece of merchandise was something I'll never forget. So I got to see him actually, you know, lead, and that had a big impact on me.
So I think one of the hallmarks of your tenure over the last, as we discussed a little bit ago, almost 4 years, coming up on 4 year anniversary, was your willingness to take some risks and to make some bets. And I was actually fortunate enough to be with you in February of 2015 when you made a pretty big bet on investing in your associates, wage increases in predictive scheduling and training and that sort of thing. And you made another big bet or another big investment in your people with the announcement last week about wage increases and bonuses and parental and maternal leave, which is really exciting. I wonder if you could talk about the way you look at your associates and the human resources inside the company and why you've made those big investments.
Yeah, sure. Maybe first just to share with everybody that since we made the announcement last week on maternity leave and parental leave, that's been the decision that we made that struck the strongest emotional chord. We extended benefits for adoptive parents and help with a little bit of cash to be able to do an adoption. And the big dollars went towards wages and this continued commitment to training and a one-time bonus and things like that. But that benefits investment ended up being a big one. So please take a look at that if you're a retailer and haven't addressed that lately. I think big picture, Matt, what everybody here that's a retailer knows is true. This is a people business. And the way that customers feel when they leave your store or they leave your website or your app determines how fast they're going to come back. And there's a piece of humanity here that really matters. And in our case, 2.3 million people around the world, most of them on the front line interacting with customers. And we want them to know how much we care about them and how much we value their work. And we want to foster a culture that supports change and helps us go along this journey that we're on, which will include even more change in the future beyond what we've already been through in the past. So as we make investments in technology and learn how to put artificial intelligence to work at Walmart or how to automate certain things that we do in a different way, we want our people to go through that with us to help contribute ideas and to be part of that process. To achieve that, we have to put them first and support them. So taking care of the basics of wages and benefits matters, but you also want to demonstrate that you're creating an opportunity for them. So that ladder that's within Walmart that somebody can climb up to, you know, be a store manager or do my job someday has got to be intact. And so the bet we're making is that over the long term, while we become in some ways a different type of technology company, we've been one for a long time, but we're becoming a different kind of technology company. As we do that, the people that are in that mix and in that process will ultimately be the way that we'll win.
when I thought I saw your letter to associates announcing the changes last week, and you referenced having a couple of conversations with associates about some of the specific benefits that weren't available. And I thought, so for a company with 2.3 million employees and the kind of global reach that you have, the fact that you could have an interaction with two or three individual associates, and that resonates with you and you make changes, I think really speaks to your commitment to the way you treat the employees and the way you invest in them.
Yeah, I think it's requirement. It's certainly how Sam Walton led. And even today in my email, I'm talking to store associates that are either telling me, great job, thank you for this, or gosh, I wish you'd done this instead of that. We're getting feedback from all over.
So what are there other kinds of investments you can make in the people, or do you see this continuing? Do you see this just as a both unique to your culture and your company, but also because of the competitive environment in which retailers operate today, that they have to make those investments in their associates and their teams?
I think it's smart strategy, and it's part of the future for everyone. In our case, as we look ahead, we'll continue to do things with wages when and as we should. We'll continue to do things with benefits along the way too. But the other piece that sometimes doesn't get talked about enough is skills development. The tools that people are using today are different than the tools that we used to use, and the tools coming for tomorrow will also be different. Maybe a few stories from recent history. I'm in a store in Oklahoma City. We're looking at a section in dry grocery in our food area. And the associate, her name is Amanda, is using an app on a mobile, on a handheld device that helps her with what we call section work. Do we have the modular or planogram set out in the right way, right number of facings, signs in the right place, accuracy, right, is the question. And she's using an app to do that and implement other things that in the past would have been either paper-based or required her to run back and forth to the back room. But now she's doing it in a more efficient, more enjoyable way, which I think is really important. And all the time that's freed up as a result of a better tool and a better process is now being used to interact with customers or to think about what she wants to feature in her department. I was in a fulfillment center not long ago where we're using a new piece of equipment that automates part of what we're doing in that center. And the associate was describing for me the before and after of how her life is different. People want these tools because the tasks that we're able to automate or digitize are not tasks that they really enjoy doing anyway, and we're freeing them up to do things that are more fun.
Yeah, higher quality, sort of an experience generally, and then it can be redeployed to do things that presumably deliver greater benefit and value for the organization.
So we've created these academies in the U.S., about 200 of them in stores. Because our inventory levels have come down, we're able to take space and put nice classrooms in the back with technology, including in some cases VR, to teach different skills. And what that'll enable us to do is to bring everyone through this process of learning how to adopt and use new technology.
And so those 200 academies, I think this was part of the 2015, the beginning of the announcement in 15 of the investment in training, hiring training and the other benefits. But you have the ability to touch all of your associates in the US within an hour or two of the academy, so they can all get there and get that training?
Well, we'll get this year, the one we just finished, 225,000 people through the academies. So we're focused on some specific skill sets we want to develop. And what we're learning is the people that we're able to get through the academies are staying longer, and the people that report to them are staying longer. So we get the benefit of retention as we train them. But we can get to everybody quickly through handheld devices and other communication, but the academies are focused on specific areas.
Yeah. So one of the other big bets, since you're talking about training and skills and capabilities, was August of 2016 and the acquisition of Jet. And I'm not sure there was more risk in that investment for you or for me, because I was on Squawk Box that morning and you and Mark Laurie were on right before I was, and they said, Doug and Mark, we're going to talk to you, but let's talk to Matt Shay and see what he thinks about this deal. And I thought, well, I know that Doug and Mark are watching this, so I better not screw it up. So there was a little bit of risk there.
Thanks.
And I guess the fact that you're here and I'm here means I didn't
appreciate
blow it
your
too
support.
Badly. Yes, thank you. So that was a big bold bet. And you know, now you've had 12 consecutive quarters in
13,
a row? Of, 13
yeah.
consecutive quarters
that
in a row of growth. So you're not in the environment you were in when you made the first investment in associates and people weren't sure where you were headed. Now people feel very confident, generally speaking, about where you're going. Can you talk about that bet? That's in some ways related to your investment in associates, but it's a technology investment and it's an investment in learning a new discipline and changing the culture as well.
Yeah. Again, probably like many of the people in the room, what's happening in our business is that we've got brick and mortar stores that we want to make better, and you can constantly be working on that, including making them more digital. We've got an e-commerce business that we want to build, make big and strong, and we've got a lot of work to do in e-commerce just to nail the fundamentals. We're trying to catch up quickly, but a lot of room to improve there. What we think is actually happening that's so promising for us is that the customer and the way they live their lives today and the way they're going to live their lives in the future actually brings that store experience and that e-commerce experience together. There's so many ways you can help people save time and have access to merchandise by using the combination of the two. And when we saw Jet, what we saw was a strong team. Mark is a merchant first, not a technologist. And the first time we met, we spent more time talking about the customer and merchandise than we did technology. And so that really clicked. And not just Mark, but many of the leaders within Jet, we really felt like we had kindred spirits there and a culture that would fit together well. We also loved what they did with Smart Cart. If you've never shopped on Jet, you can save money as a customer by making decisions that help us lower costs. So if you use a debit card instead of a credit card, you save money. You give up a return privilege on a consumable you're never going to bring back, you save money. You buy two of this or this with that, you save money. And as you do that, the retailer ends up with a bigger basket. And because of the value of economics of a basket versus an each, that's certainly in our favor. And so we're happy to share those savings with the customer. And the way that Mark and the team had built that particular feature was really attractive to us. We also picked up another brand, and it's complementary, another tech platform. And what we decided to do to try and empower them was to give them big jobs leading all of e-commerce in the US. So Mark leads Walmart.com and Jet.com, and as we've bought Shoes.com and Bonobos and other businesses, Mark's leading all of that and doing a great job doing so. So we're bringing along that speed to build a big and important e-commerce business and working together. Greg Foran, who's doing a masterful job leading the stores, teamed up with Mark to develop solutions for customers that are seamless. And that's ultimately where we think, you know, we can win.
Yeah. You know, Mark was good enough to come out to our shop.org conference in Los Angeles last September and did a conversation like this one. And in the conversation about chasing technology and e-commerce and online, I think his exact quote was, you know, don't forget that this is simply a means to an end, and the end is to make yourself a better merchant. And I think that's very consistent with what you said you felt the connection with Mark and his team about, because that seems to be, you know, the way the business goes. And I guess related to that then, you know, we hear a lot over the course of the last year in particular about a retail apocalypse or the death of retail and the headlines and the analyst report. And there's a serious fixation on, you know, winners and losers in the marketplace. How do you think about that? How do you react when you see a headline like that or you see a broadcast program and someone says retail is dying and retail's going to go the way of the dodo bird? What's your reaction to that?
Wasn't it Mark Twain that said the rumors of my death have been greatly exaggerated?
Yes.
Yeah. I think John Wayne used that in a movie once too, so I'll give him credit for it too. That's to say that is to underestimate the creativity and the ability to execute of the people in this room. And there are a lot of creative people who can make things happen in this room and in retail. And what goes through my mind is the person who ultimately decides whether we're here or not is the customer. It's a busy family. It's the people that are making choices all the time about where they want to shop. And they're very rational. They make choices. Sometimes it may be subconscious or intuitive, but they ultimately make choices about price, assortment, and experience. Where can I get the best value? Because most people are working really hard, counting every dollar that they're making, and value is always going to matter. Price will always matter. Assortment, wow, it's amazing how much assortment is available for people today on a mobile device. I think we're up to over 70 million items now.
Right. From 10 million just a couple of years ago.
Yeah. When I started in retail, if you'd have told me that was going to happen, I would have said that's impossible. But it's not impossible. There's so much today that is possible. And then that other dimension, that third dimension of experience, you know, did you take the friction out? Did you save me time? Did you help me be informed about what it is that I'm buying? Is it good for humanity? Is it good for the planet? I want to know a lot about the items that I'm buying today, and I want to know more about the company that I'm buying it from or the person that I'm buying it from. So if we move in a way that helps us increase value, continues to offer the broad assortment they're looking for, and then constantly be improving the experience, whether it's on an app, through the spoken voice, someday through VR, regardless of the vehicle. If we're better at that, we're going to be here. And if we're not, we won't.
Right. So you've obviously made the big bets in people and continue to do that. Some big bets, you mentioned Jet, but then Bonomos and some of the others that Mark and his team are leading. As you think about other ways in which you can involve, or you think of other ways in which retailers can and should be evolving or investing or other dimensions, you just talked about some of them, but are there other things that you think about and say, we need to do more of this or invest in this or get better at this?
Yeah. Well, two thoughts come to mind. The first one is the work that we're talking about that the customer sees and hopefully sees quickly actually is from within. You know, shaping the culture of the organization, the behaviors of the organization, and literally how we work is ultimately probably more than anything else going to decide whether we win with customers or not. So what that looks like in some cases is a company that had a core group of silos, merchandising, operations, logistics, marketing, etc., that start to work in an agile fashion across those silos, in some ways more like a tech company. And I think we're learning how to do that, and that enables speed, effectiveness, and efficiency, and I suspect that many people in the room are going through this as well. The other thing that comes to mind is the ability, in our case for sure, and I'm sure with many others, to use the scale of the company for good. You know, if you assume that the world is going to become increasingly transparent and everyone's going to be increasingly informed, when they look at your company, do they feel good about the decisions that you're making? And some of the decisions we make are tough decisions. They're not always going to be popular. But if the decisions you're making around your supply chain to make them more sustainable socially and environmentally, and in our case, we can make a decision to take on greenhouse gases, which we've done. We can make a decision to take toxins out of certain products that might have been there before, which we've done. We can work with our suppliers to make an even bigger difference, which we're doing. I think that stuff matters some today and matters more, you know, to a minority of the customer base. But over time, that's just going to grow and become increasingly important. So it's passing that transparency test with flying colors, I think, is another thing we can be working on.
Yeah, and that's transparency in everything, right? In your pricing, in your marketing efforts, in your supply chain, and in your sustainability efforts. And reading that press release about your appointment from now more than 4 years ago, sustainability was one of the things, a dimension that got mentioned, and that's core to Walmart's philosophy, but also something that you've touched on. Could you talk about some specific examples of areas in which you're proud of some of the work you're doing there?
Yeah, sure. What happened in our company is that, you know, Sam, when he started Walmart, was really focused on two stakeholder groups, customers and associates. And if you're winning with customers and you're treating your people well and they've got skin in the game, we created profit sharing and shared information with department managers, all kinds of choices that he and other leaders made to pull customer or associates into this process, everything else will work out. Take care of customers and associates. And at some point, Walmart became big and societal expectations changed and we missed the memo. We were still really focused on customers and associates. And in the early years when the newspapers would write good things about Walmart because it was a Cinderella story out of a small town in the middle of the country, Sam would say, don't read those papers. Don't let any of that go to your head. Focus on customers and associates. And then later years when the newspapers might have started to criticize us because societal expectations went up and we weren't matching them all, we also ignored that. And then we went through this phase where it was, well, if they criticize us, we'll come back with facts. And that didn't really work. So we got to a point, and Lee Scott was our CEO, where Lee said, what if instead of doing what we've been doing, we really listen to our critics? Let's go meet them face to face. Let's find the people that dislike us the most and go figure out why and see if there's some good in what they're saying and then implement it. And it really started a journey towards becoming more sustainable. And right about in the middle of that, Hurricane Katrina happened. And if any of you were following Hurricane Katrina and the situation that happened in New Orleans, government was not responding fast enough, and we were moving with product and other things, and during that Labor Day weekend, we had a conference call, and Lee said on the phone to all of us, this one's really bad. This situation in New Orleans is not something we've ever seen. Things are not getting better fast enough. I want you to unleash your teams, and let's do whatever we can do. Send people, send products, send money. We will worry about what it costs later. And there was a surge. And there are incredible stories about our people helping helicopters land on the parking lots to rescue people and administering CPR. And it was just this heroic time. And after it was over with, in the days and weeks that followed, we all looked at each other and said, what would it take for us to be that company all the time? Because it reminded us of what it was like to feel good about working at Walmart in a different way. And so that really added fuel to this sustainability fire. So today we've set some of the output of that now 10 years later. We've set a goal of getting a gigaton of carbon out of our system. We took out over 20 million metric tons in the last few years together with our suppliers. We're taking on initiatives to be supplied even more by renewable energy. We're about a third of the way there. We're eliminating waste. We've set a goal of getting to 0% waste in many of our countries. We've got some countries that are over 90% already. So it's waste, it's energy. It's also how people are treated, you know, in the instance of Thai fishing, Bangladesh factories. Right. We can set policies, make decisions, and help people to make the entire supply chain better. And what we've learned is it also generates good financial results. We save money, we eliminate waste, so the whole cycle works together.
Yeah, that really was an inflection point too. I mean, the iconic photos of the Walmart trucks all staged and ready to get into New Orleans as soon as they could get in, and the other things, and a cultural transformation maybe as much as anything else in terms of, as you said, the way it brought energy and a kind of a renewed sense of a commitment to the philosophy. I want to ask you about international exposure. We have obviously a lot of international attendees at the event this week, and maybe 8 or 10,000 of our attendees are from around the world, so a very global show. How do you think about the changing face of the consumer and all the markets in which you operate and the distinctions and the diversity of those markets? How do you approach that with your team and preserve the core elements of the things you want to accomplish, recognizing that you're doing this across a really diverse set of jurisdictions and markets?
Mm-hmm. Well, today we operate retail stores or websites, e-commerce businesses in 28 different countries. We're in Africa, sub-Saharan Africa, China, India, Japan, the UK, throughout the Americas. And, you know, retail is local in many ways. Some of the assortment needs to be local. We empower people locally to make decisions about how they run their business and certainly how to assort their business and how to market it. But I think what I'm seeing, I was responsible for our international business for 5 years, and then I've been in this role for four and travel all over the world, seeing what's happening. I'm seeing more commonality in terms of how technology is impacting these conversations. Everywhere around the world, people want to save money and they want to save time. I was in a customer's home in an Asian country not long ago, and it was an emerging Asian country, and the woman that we were talking to about how she lives and how she shops had sent a text message on an old flip phone to a produce delivery guy who showed up at the house while we were there with a wooden wheelbarrow and delivered three beautiful tomatoes. And she told him that morning, I want three tomatoes, and. That's e-commerce. That's mobile commerce.
Yeah. Yep.
That's digital commerce in a low-budget way. And whether it's sub-Saharan Africa or it's in the U.S., China is off the charts as it relates to digital and e-commerce, and I'm sure everybody knows that, but we are currently learning more coming out of China than we are in any other country in the world. The way that adoption has worked there, we have a relationship with JD.com. We own 10% of JD in China, one of the fastest growing e-commerce businesses, and own a small portion of a delivery company that's doing last mile delivery. And in China, you know, as a customer, you can get delivery for about a US dollar frequently in 30 minutes from one of our stores. So that's a different set of economics than we have in the US, which is why adoption's so much higher. But it's really great that we're able to experience that and learn it and not only adapt in China, but adapt in the US and other places.
So a few years ago, a senior Walmart executive was at this conference, in fact, and announcing the commitment to manufacturing in the United States, among other things. And I can remember a comment that was made that the United States can't be a country that only sells things. We have to be a country that also makes things. And they have to have a more diversified, integrated sort of an economy in order to be successful. How do you think about, we just got tax reform done. Obviously, you were able to invest some of that in your associates, and retailers will make other decisions about how to make those investments over the year. How do you feel about the U.S. economy, the global economy, as you look out at your prospects going forward, and just sort of GDP growth, those kinds of things?
Yeah, good. I think we're in a really positive environment right now. And it's true beyond just the U.S., but if you just look at the U.S. for a moment, we've got low gas prices, we've got tax reform happening, we've got optimism on the part of the customer that I haven't seen in a while. I think this last quarter's holiday growth, the numbers are bearing that out. So we're in a good spot right now from a consumption point of view and a purchasing point of view. We need to not get comfortable. We've got a lot of work to do to position the company to be successful going forward. So you certainly can't slow down change. And as it relates to U.S. tax reform, I do think that it will drive some growth. You know, I think the investments that we've already announced and some others that we'll share as we go through the year will help drive even more growth for a period of time. We need to make sure the decisions we're making we're proud of in 3 and 5 years' time, though, and not just in 12 months.
So I guess we talked about all of these challenges and opportunities across a very large, very complex, mature organization. You're maybe going to be the last CEO that actually interacted with Sam Walton and was able to work with him directly and experience that. He seemed to have such a commitment to the cultural basis on which the company was built. With 2.3 million employees across the country and 11 or 12,000 stores, how do you keep the culture going? How do you remind people of your core values of integrity and respect and service? When you have those conversations, how do you do that in an organization with that kind of size?
It's probably job number one. And in our case, Sam's characteristics, I think, have lived on. He passed away in 1992. It's 2018. And I don't mean this in a spooky way, but sometimes people that join Walmart will talk about him like they expect to see him coming around the corner in the office or in a store at any moment. He's still kind of present.
Yep.
He'd laugh about all that, I'm sure, if he were still here. But somehow I think we've been able to carry on his best characteristics. And he gave us a really clear purpose. In 1992, shortly before he passed away, President H.W. Bush came to Bentonville and gave him the Presidential Medal of Freedom. And Sam was battling cancer, and he stood up out of his wheelchair, and he said, "The secret is that we're all working together. And as long as we continue to work together and get ideas from all over the company, we're going to be able to show people around the world what it's like to save money and have a better life, to have a better lifestyle." And today, that's save money, live better, and that purpose, I think, will be timeless for Walmart, and it doesn't matter who the CEO is.
Yeah.
And then we have 4 core values, and I think those are going to stand the test of time. We respect the individual. We strive for excellence. We serve the customer, and we act with integrity. And if we get our behaviors to match those values, not just, you know, to be a slogan or something we say, but actually how things work in every store and in every part of the company, this thing's going to keep going. And beyond that, Sam gave us servant leadership. Mm-hmm. Put other people first. You lead from the bottom, or you lead from behind. And he gave us a culture of change. If this were a Walmart meeting and these were all Walmart associates, we could say one of the things that's constant at Walmart is, and the group would yell back, change.
Yeah.
And that gives us a shot. So what we've tried to do in recent times is to say the purpose is the purpose, the values are the values, everything else is open to debate and may change. And we'll try to always explain why, but we got to be ready to go, because retail is about change. It's probably the reason that many people in this room like it so much, is
yep.
that it's challenging.
Never boring.
Fast paced. Man, I'm not bored. If you're bored right now, you're not paying attention.
So I guess as we wrap up, and I'm sort of burying the lead here a little bit, For those of you that don't know, Doug is going to be honored with the Visionary Award tonight at our Foundation Gala, which is a great tribute to you and your leadership, although I know that you're going to say this is about the team and the associates.
For sure.
And so, I mean, I thought I'd give you one more opportunity to say that about the associates and the team. And that's as you've said in your note to associates about the changes you made last week and the bonuses, and that, you know, as an associate myself, and I guess that's really an element of the culture, isn't it? And that's how you think of the team. You're all on the same team.
Absolutely. It's a team sport. Okay. You know, the work happens in every department and every store and in every part of the business. And again, I think the hardworking, dedicated associates that make sure every customer while they're in that store are experiencing us in some other way, that it goes well and it goes right, is where all this matters. Yeah. It's really the only thing that matters. We often say we don't have any cash registers in the office. That's less true today because of e-commerce.
Right, right.
But the concept
yeah,
still applies.
Concept holds. Yeah, well, congratulations to you and the entire team on behalf of the Visionary Award, and it's certainly great recognition for the leadership that you and the company have demonstrated over the time you've been the CEO and beyond. Thank you for being here for this conversation, for your great partnership and support for the National Retail Federation. We are
very
grateful.
Thanks for the job you're doing.
Thank you.
Thank you.